Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Donna Mineo. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dial Teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question.
We'll get to the math maze in just a second, but first we would like to let our viewers know that a little later in the show, Howard Krug will be here to talk to us about some leading ladies and tell us about their accomplishments. And now let's get to the math maze.
Okay.
How are the ordered pairs 4, 9 and 4, negative 9 similar, and how are they different? Are the two points related by a reflection over an axis in the coordinate plane?
Okay, but now we're going to give you a few seconds to write this down. Again, tonight's Math Maze question is, how are the ordered pairs 4, 9 and 4, negative 9 similar, and how are they different? Are the two points related by a reflection over an axis in the coordinate plane?
If you think you can solve the math maze, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But remember, every correct response we add at our Hotline Hall of Fame are enough points so you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
It is okay. Time to do some homework.
Hello, Chester, are you there?
Yes.
How are you today?
Good.
Good. Now, what grade are you in, Chester?
Fourth,
and where do you go to school?
Walter C. Black.
All right, let me go to the board. I understand you have a math question, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the question we're working on?
How many gold coins were in the pot before Katie discovered it?
Okay, so there must have been something that goes before that. Is there more in the question?
Katie found a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow.
Okay.
She counted the coins and took out 1/3 of them.
Okay.
She put half her coins into each of her two pockets.
Okay.
And there were 5 coins in each pocket.
Okay.
How many gold coins were in the pot before Katie discovered it?
Okay, let's look what we got here, Chester. I made a little diagram while you're reading. So she found a pot of gold, okay?
Yeah.
Now, she counted and she took 1/3 of the coins out of that pot of gold, right?
Yeah.
So what I originally drew up here was a pie here, and it's divided into thirds, although I didn't draw them very evenly, all right?
Yeah.
So far, so good? Now, there's two ways we can approach this. After that, it says she took the coins, divided them evenly, we turned her two pockets, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We could either figure out how many coins she has altogether, that's 1/3, or are you supposed to then divide this into sixths? Is that how your teacher's been having you do it? Were you drawing a diagram? Let's look at it both.
Yeah.
Okay, let's look at it both ways. First, if she takes that 1/3 and divides it in half, and that's basically what she did, which she put part in each pocket, right? If we would look at our original diagram, if we divide each of these in half, how many pieces do we have now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So far, so good? Okay?
Yeah, far so good.
Okay. Each sixth, though, is equal to 5, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. So we could put 5 in each one of these, right?
Yes.
And how many would that give us? If we counted them up, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Okay? 5 times 6. Now, the other way we could have done it, though, is originally we looked at it. She had 5 coins in each pocket. How many did she have all together was 10, right?
Uh-huh.
All right. And so if we kept our original thirds, we'd see then each third would have been 10. And once again, we would have gotten 30. So there's two ways you could approach that. And I think either one would have been fine. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Nice job. Thanks for calling, Chester.
Okay.
All right. Bye-bye.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
We have Jessica on the line. Hello, Jessica.
Hello.
Hi, I'm going to walk to the board. And while we're doing that, what kind of problem do we have for tonight?
I have a fraction problem.
A fraction problem. Okay. Is it a word problem or just a bunch of numbers together?
A word problem.
Okay, it's a word problem. Do you want to read that to me?
Okay.
Go ahead.
It says, Ava, Carter, Luke, and their dad each mow a different section of their yard. Ava mows 1/12 of the yard. Carter mows 2/12 of the yard. And Luke mows 4/12 of the yard. Their dad mows the rest of the yard. Draw a model to represent the yard. Show the fraction of the yard their dad mows.
All right. So you said to show, do a model?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you mind if we do like a, can we draw a rectangle for the lawn? Is that okay with you?
Okay.
All right. So I'm going to draw this into a rectangle. And then I'm going to cut this lawn right in half. And I know that all my denominators are 12. So I'm going to make sure I have 12 sections. Okay. And if I do 6, 2, 4, oops, I'm not a very good artist. We're gonna add a little more, that's 5. And we'll add on this end, there's 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then 6 on the bottom. So I have a total of 12, okay? So now let's, who was the first person you said?
The person we have to find out that moves the rest is the dad.
Okay, the dad. So who did 1/12?
1/12 was Ava.
So I'm going to write her name in 1/12 of this picture, okay? And who did 2/12?
2/12 was Carter.
Carter? I'm just going to put a C instead of writing all that out. How about the 4/12?
4/12 was Luke.
Luke? Okay, so let's put an L for Luke. 2, 3, and 4. So now we have all of the ones done that are already there, right? And we got to figure out what Dad did. Well, I've got this picture, and I have to put a D for Dad. It looks like Dad has to do the most. It's a good thing he's older, right?
Yeah.
So how much of the lawn was done in our picture here? What you're going to do is take all the numerators and add them up. All right?
Okay.
So what's 1 plus 2?
1 plus 2 is 3.
Okay, and what's 3 plus 4?
7.
7. So 7/12 of the lawn is done. Okay, by all the kids, they did all that. Dad has to do the rest. Well, what would I do to find how much was left?
Okay, by all the kids, they did all that.
Listen to me in the phone, sweetheart. So if I take the 12 12s, do you agree that 12 out of 12 is one whole?
Okay.
12 out of 12 is one whole, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to write my yard as 12 out of 12. I know 7/12 of it is finished. So I'm going to take 7 away from that. What's 12 take away 7?
12 takeaway 7 is... yeah.
12 takeaway 7. What's 10 takeaway 3?
10 takeaway 3 is 7.
7. And so now we take away another 2.
Which is 5.
5. So it's 12 minus 7 is 5, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So Dad did 5/12 of the lawn. And your picture is here to show that as well. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for calling, sweetie.
I said, hey, hey.
When multiplying fractions, begin by multiplying the numerators of the fraction, and then multiplying the denominators of the fraction.
We'll get back to the questions in a minute, but tonight on Homework Hotline, we would like to finish up our celebration of Women's History Month. Many people might think that the women's fight for equality is over, but that is far from true. Tonight, we take a closer look at some of the issues that women still face today.
Modern issues on women's rights and women's equality all stem from the Seneca Falls Convention here in 1848. Now, the wording might not be the same, but many of the demands that they made here in 1848 are. Now, in 1920, women gained the right to vote by the passage of the 19th Amendment. But that's not the only demand that they made here in Seneca Falls. There were many issues that were continued to be fought throughout the 1900s and are still being fought today. Issues regarding pay and job equality. They usually weren't even able to do the same work as a man. Professions like attorneys, doctors, judges were all male. So this sort of discrimination against women in professions that we see today where they're not making the same wages stems from what happened here in Seneca Falls, that first they had to demand the ability to get into these jobs. Now today they're fighting for the rights to be compensated the same for doing those jobs.
In my lifetime, things have changed so much. From the time that I was born, when there were separate want ads in the paper for people who were men and women, different advertisements, to assumptions about what you could do. When I was in junior high school, our team in volleyball was qualified to go into the quarterfinals for the state. When it came time for us to leave school at 3:00, the vice principal wouldn't let us go early because we were just a girls' team and girls' sports couldn't leave school early. There's still a lot of places where women either get paid less for different work or where they don't have opportunities to do what they want to do. We still have a long way to go for everyone to have the access to equal pay for equal work, for equal opportunity.
Equal pay is a matter of simple fairness, right? I should be paid the same amount as my male colleagues. Some of whom also have the complicating factors of a family, you know, which may have some impact on their relation to their work lives, or need to have that balance between work life and home life. There are some areas where we still have a ways to go. Again, salary disparities certainly are still there, and these are things that we're seeking to overcome. As well as the way that women are represented, girls and women are represented in our media, which is not necessarily empowering, even though it's sometimes labeled empowered. Most of the media that's directed at all of us, the popular culture, limit the paths or opportunities for girls to be a model or to be a mom or something along that line. And I would encourage young girls and women to look at the world around them to see if there are problems that they can, that they see that need to be fixed, to think like that reformer, the generation of reformers from the middle of the 19th century. There are challenges that our community and our society face, And we have the right to stand up and speak out. And young girls today have not only still retained that right, but they also have the ability and the to stand up and take a public stance in favor of causes that affect them and the world around them.
Okay, now if you'd like to watch this video again or others like it, you can visit our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on our Women's History Month button. And now we'd like to welcome our history teacher, Howard Krug, to the Homework Hotline. What are we going to learn about tonight, Howard?
We are going to learn about the 19th Amendment, and we're going to learn about leading ladies in history. Right. I got a question for you, Joe.
Okay.
What year was the first woman elected to the United States House of Representatives? Do you know?
I'm going to guess 20s. When they got the vote, I'm not sure.
Good guess.
Nope.
But that's why we need to watch tonight on
right.
History Hotline, okay?
Okay.
So walk with me over to the board, would you? And this, by the way, is Elizabeth Cady Stanton. And she's asking, how long do you mean to keep us from waiting? And I went back in a history machine. And I appear with her. And she's even laughing because that's pretty funny. But we want to talk something tonight a little bit serious, okay? Oh, my. That wasn't supposed to be like that. Seneca Falls, 1848, was the chance for women to have a right to speak out. And what they did was they wrote down these words, "We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men and women are created equal." But wait a minute, we heard those words before, didn't we? Those of you watching, who said those? What was his name? It starts with a T. He wrote the Declaration of... That's right, Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson did write, "We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal." However, the women got together with some other men and they said, "Men and women are created equal." Now, why would they say this? Do you ever wonder about that, Donna? Yeah. Well, they had some serious problems back then. Problems such as women weren't allowed to own property. You couldn't own property if you were a woman. Isn't that crazy? Couldn't own your own house. Couldn't own your own horse. Wait a minute, but it gets bad. They're not allowed to keep the money they earn. When you earned your money, you had to give it to your husband or your father. You weren't even allowed to have it. And another thing that happened to them, women who got a divorce, they lost everything. Everything was gone. And when a husband dies, that property went to the oldest male who had to take care of the mom. But if the oldest son didn't like the mom, he could put her out in the back woodshed and nobody would say anything. That's not good, right? So these women got together in 1848 and they came up with some ideas. Number one, they resolved that women should have the right to vote. And that's why it's called right to the elective. Another thing they said, they resolved that women should have equality and it shouldn't be based on race. Remember Martin Luther King said, "I have a dream that all people, all colors"? Well, the women back in 1848 said, "Hey, it doesn't matter your race, it doesn't matter your color, it doesn't matter if you're male or female. We should all have the right to vote." But you think the guys gave them a right to vote right away, Joe? Nah, they didn't. In fact, they said, "Oh, no, if women get the right to vote, look, they're going to start dressing like men. They're going to put on a coat. They're going to start wearing hats. They're going to start taking up manly duties. And the men are going to become like the women. Why, it's going to be just terrible." And that's what they thought. And in fact, if you go out there and you type in 10 reasons for women not to vote, you can find it. It's New Jersey and New York, the anti-suffrage movement. A bunch of gentlemen and some ladies got together and said, "No, we don't want women to have the right to vote. They'll lose their dignity. It'd be terrible." So they passed the joint resolution in the 66th Congress of the United States, 1920. But when you pass a resolution and it goes through Congress and it's voted by the Senate, before it can become an amendment, two-thirds of the states have to decide. And that's where the story of Harry. Have you ever heard about Harry Burns? Harry Burns was a pretty cool guy. He was 24 years old, and he lived in Tennessee. And here's the deal about Harry Burns. He was 24, and he was in the last state, Tennessee, that had to vote for ratification. And all Harry had to do was vote yes, and women would have gotten the right to vote. But he voted no. He wore a red rose And that meant he was no. People who had a yellow rose were yes. So they could count going in. And Harry Rode had a red rose on his lapel every day when they went to vote. And for 3 weeks, they argued it out. And they discussed it. And they said, we want the right to vote. And then one morning, Harry's mother wrote him a letter. And on it, she said, Harry, be a good boy. Help Mrs. Cat and put the rat in ratification. Harry voted yes that morning. And then right after the vote, people were so mad at him, he ran up the stairs into the third floor chamber and hid till the crowds died down because they were so mad that he voted yes. Thank you, Harry. And thanks, Phoebe, because you told your son, Mr. Burns, to vote yes. And that's why women have the right to vote today, because of Harry Burns. But you know what? A lot has happened since the 20th Amendment has been passed, and there's the wording of it right there, that the rights of citizens to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on the account of sex. And it took them from 1848 all the way to 1920 before they got the rights. But here's your question, Joe. She was the first woman elected to the House of Representatives. Her name was Jeanette Rankin, and she went in 1914. She got elected. Another first was Natalie Toyo Ross, and she was the first woman to become governor of Wyoming. She was elected in 1923. Here's another first, Cora Bell Reynolds Anderson. She was the first Native American ever elected in the House of Representatives in Michigan. Here's the first woman to win the Nobel Peace Prize, Jane Addams. She started Hull House in Chicago. Do you see the way she's dressed? She looks like a what?
Astronaut.
That's right, she's an astronaut. And she would be the youngest astronaut and the first woman to ever walk in space. Isn't that amazing? And here we have the first secretary of Secretary of State, 2001. All that time to 2001, first secretary, Madeleine Albright, and she'd also be an ambassador for the UN. And right here is Condoleezza Rice. She'd be the first African-American woman to serve as both a national security advisor and the Secretary of State. So women have made quite a jump, haven't they? And who's this?
Hillary Clinton.
And you know what, folks? She's running in 2016 to be president, possibly. She ran in 2008 against Barack Obama, and she became his Secretary of State. But for all the good that has happened to women, guess what? This is a male cop, female cop. Did you know that women get paid less than men? Look at that. For every dollar earned for a man, the woman might do the same job, only earning 85 cents. So, my message today, for all of you young ladies who are out there watching right now, don't miss this. This is the most important part. You be the change. And who knows, someday you could be the first in your family, in your community, to go out there and make a change. If those women could do it, you can too. The world is yours.
I said, hey, hey.
How do you know which century you live in? The 21st century is the 2000s. The 20th century is the 1900s. The 19th century is the 1800s. The 18th century is the 1700s, 17th century is the 1600s, and so on.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's Math Maze. Let's go over to Donna with the answer.
Hello, who do I have on the phone here?
I'm De'Aaron Glisson.
Okay, and do you know the answer?
That's the two.
Okay, what's the answer?
Okay, both coordinates are the same because the x-axis for both numbers are both 4.
Okay, so your x-axis or x value is equals 4. Okay, and how are they different?
They're different because one of them is in the first quadrant, which is all positive numbers, and the other is in the fourth quadrant, where the X numbers are negative. Wait, okay. No, the X numbers are positive, and the Y numbers are negative.
So your Y's are different then, and the different quadrants. Okay, now, the last part was, are they related by a reflection over an axis?
Yes, they're both reflected over the X axis.
All right, they're both reflected over the X?
Yes.
All right, so let's do this. How, I'm gonna come over and put my point, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and go up to negative, or up to positive 9. Here's the first point. And then if you come down, here's your other point, right? So B is a reflection of A, or A is a reflection of B, because they're on the same X, on the same X value and the same distance from the axes. Excellent job. Thank you for calling us.
Okay, that's all the time we have for tonight. Tune in tomorrow for Homework Hotline.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.